Hi everyone, and welcome to today's webcast on over-determinate kinematic analysis in the anybody modeling system. So to give you a quick outline on what we've lined up for you today, we'll start with a general introduction of our two speakers. So the first to go will be Dr. Michael Skipper Andersen, who is an associate professor at Aalborg University. So Dr. Andersen's PhD thesis was titled Kinematically Over-determinate Systems. So he is essentially the brains behind many of the kinematic algorithms that we have today in the anybody modeling system. In 2015, he was awarded the prestigious Sapir Award Research Fellowship, which is awarded by the Danish Council for Independent Research. And in the year 2014, he was a winning member of, or a member of the winning team for the Grand Knee Challenge contest. So his current research mainly focuses on the development of novel musculoskeletal simulation methods, which are focused on hip and knee orthopedics. So next to go would be Professor John Rasmussen, who is a professor at Aalborg University. So John actually began his career as a finite element analyst, or a finite element analyst. And most of his research actually focused on structural and topology optimization. And sometime in the 90s, he started wondering whether these same optimization techniques could be applied to the human musculoskeletal system. And that is how the anybody modeling system was born. So today he continues to serve as the chief technical officer of Anybody Technology, which is the company that that makes the software. And he's also a professor at the Anybody Research Group at Aalborg University. So Michael will be talking about the math behind over-determinate kinematics, while John, who would follow him, will talk about the applications to musculoskeletal modeling. And we will, of course, have some final words and a Q&A session towards the end of both their presentation. So for those of you who are also new to the anybody modeling system, I would just like to clarify a few terms over here because you may hear them in the course of the presentation today. So the anybody modeling system essentially consists of two parts. So the first is the software which actually runs your simulation, and this is what we call the anybody modeling system. But also packaged along with it is the anybody managed model repository, or the AMMR as we abbreviate it. And this is essentially a library of human body models that we regularly update and curate based on the latest publications. So you would, for your typical study using anybody, would combine both of these components in order to achieve your goals. A quick overview of how the simulation works is the three essential components are, of course, the human body model, which you see in the middle, and then the motion and the forces that you want to subject the human body model to. And it's during these motions that you're actually interested in computing the muscle forces. And an optional component of your model is a model of the environment. So this is when there is some kind of interaction between the human and a device, or it could just be a fixed object that actually forms the motion environment. And you can essentially fuse all three of these together into a single model in anybody. This is what we call the man-machine model. And you can then run a kinematic analysis and an inverse dynamics analysis, which will essentially, it'll make your model move or make your model carry out the motion which you've prescribed. And at the same time, it'll calculate the internal body loads, such as the muscle forces and the joint forces during this motion. So if this does not form your end goal, you may want to pass your data on for post-processing onto finite element tools such as Abacus and Ansys. And we have interfaces to help you do this. And in some cases, you may want to run design optimization studies inside anybody where you're designing an optimal environment for human motion. So the applications that we typically see anybody being applied to, well, it's a pretty wide range, but if we had to roughly classify them under these five different categories, you can see that they range from product design optimization to all the way to generating load cases for finite element analysis. So On that note, I would like to hand the word over to Michael Skipper Andersen, who will inform us on the math governing these over-determinate kinematic simulations.
What I'll be talking about today is basically kinematic analysis, and in particular over-determinate kinematics. So when we do the analysis of these musculoskeletal systems, the very first thing we need to do in order to estimate the internal forces and the muscle forces is to do a kinematic analysis. And this is an analysis of the motion without consideration of the forces that cause this motion. And this requires that we have a description of the bodies that are involved. So these can either be rigid bodies or they can be flexible bodies. In the anybody modeling system, we assume that all the bones and all the segments are rigid. We also have to make a model and a description of the connections between these, which is the description of joints. And then we need a description of the movement of this particular mechanism or body that we are then analyzing. And then the goal of a kinematic analysis is then to compute the positions, velocities, and accelerations of these bodies. Because once we know these, we can then substitute them into the Newton-Euler equation and then compute what the forces and moments required to produce this moment are. So a very basic concept that we need to have in mind when we look at and talk about kinematic analysis, and also that John later on in the example would be needing as well, is the concept of the degrees of freedom of a mechanical system. And this is the number of independent ways of motion for a mechanical system. And if we look at it in 3D, then the way we can count the number of degrees of freedom that a mechanical system has is if we look at this equation here. So if we take one body, so we have n bodies in our system, then each of these, if they're unconstrained, they have 6 degrees of freedom. So this gives the total number of degrees of freedom in this case would be 6 times the number of bodies, because each body have 3 translations and then 3 rotations if they're unconstrained. And then if we from this then subtract all the constraints that are coming from the joints, then we have the number of degrees of freedom that this mechanism has available. And these we call n DOF. Besides this, because we wanted to do a kinematic analysis, I need to somehow describe what these n degrees of freedom are doing. And this is where we typically have motion information and then constraints that then specify what these are, we call kinematic drivers. If we just come up with a little example of this, just to show you how we could actually count the number of degrees of freedom of a mechanical system. So if we have just a simplified leg model here, it has pelvis and a right leg. So we have pelvis, femur, tibia, and foot. These are our segments we have available. And then I have made some simplified assumptions of joints in this model that are used in the literature. So if we could, for instance, make a model of the hip as a spherical joint, the knee as a revolute joint, and then the ankle as a universal joint, which allows 2 degrees of freedom at the ankle. So if we then count it up, so a spherical joint takes away 3 degrees of freedom, but it allows 3 rotations, but does not allow any translations between the two bodies. A revolute joint only allows rotation around one axis, which means that subtracts 5 degrees of freedom. And then a universal joint allows rotation around 2 axes, so which means that it takes away 4 relative degrees of freedom between the two bodies. So if we then do the little calculation on it here, so 4 times the 6 degrees of freedom per the bodies, 24. And then a spherical joint takes away 3 degrees of freedom, revolute joint 5 degrees of freedom, and a universal joint 4 degrees of freedom. So this means there are 12 degrees of freedom in this mechanical system. In anybody, the way we actually set up the equations of so the kinematic constrained equations is what is called the full Cartesian formulation is what is used. And the idea of that is that whenever we introduce a body in the segment, a body in the model, it also introduces 6 unknowns. So 3 positions and then 3 rotation. In practice, we actually introduce 7 because we use Euler parameters as the rotation coordinates and a constraint. But that's a technicality for now. So let's just take a look at just a very schematic mechanical system we have over here. So whenever we introduce a segment, I introduce Q1 here and Q2, Q3, and Q4. And each of these will then include 6 elements. So that means that whenever I introduce a segment, I introduce six unknowns. So six unknowns are added. And then whenever we introduce a joint constraint, so for instance here between body number one and ground, or between body one and two, and so forth, we then add equations. And then of course, depending on how many equations I set up compared to how many unknowns I have, I might be able to solve these. If I have as many equations as unknowns, I might also have too few equations, or I might have too many equations. So let's take a look at how this would be in general. So the equations would then be something that looks like this. So we have our coordinates, so which would be a vector including for each body six unknowns, and then a vector that includes the six times the number of bodies. And then these coordinates, they vary as a function of time. So this is what is illustrated here. Then we also have the equations that are a function of then these coordinates, and they might also be explicit functions of time. So all the constraint equations that specify motion, these will be equations where it's an explicit function of time. Joint constraint will only be a function of the coordinates. And these then have to be equal to zero. So then depending on how many constraint equations we have, we might end up in different situations. So if we take a look here, so the situation where we have more degrees of freedom than we have specified driver equations. So this is a kinematically underdeterminate system. So I have actually fewer equations than I have unknowns. So that means that I cannot solve this equation system as such. So we don't have enough driver information to fully describe the motion. And this is also the most general case in the dynamics of mechanical systems. So if we actually wanted to do an analysis in a situation like this, we actually have to also look at the forces that actually produce the motion, because we cannot just solve the kinematic constraint equations, but these together with the dynamic equilibrium equations can be used to actually determine the motion. And in that case, we would then have to solve the second order differential equation of motion, which you typically do by some sort of forward dynamics simulations approach. This is beyond what we will be talking about today. Another situation we could end it is in the case where we have exactly as many driver equations as we have degrees of freedom. And this is called a kinematically determinate system. So we have as many drivers as we have degrees of freedom. And if these are actually independent equations, so the driver equations and the joint constraints are independent, we might be able to find a solution for these equations, but these are actually nonlinear equations, so there might be multiple solutions, there might also not be a solution, even though we have enough equations. But theoretically, if the solution exists, we are able to find them in this case. So this means that the motion is completely prescribed by the drivers, so we should be able to solve kinematics on its own without considering the kinetics or the forces that actually caused it, and which implies that kinematics and then kinetic analysis become two decoupled problems. The last situation, which is actually the theme of today's webcast, is the overdeterminate case, which would be the case where we have more drivers than we have degrees of freedom. So this means that we actually have specified more driver information than we strictly need. And in general, we can then not solve the equations because we have too many equations compared to the number of degrees of freedom. And unless we have written the same equation multiple times so that they're basically they are dependent on each other, these equations, so they're not independent, then there's no solution to them. So, and then if we want to actually be able to even define what a solution is or actually use it for something, we then have to allow violations on some of these constraint equations. And this is what we'll be talking about. So ways to introduce allowed violations on some of the equations. So the whole motivation of this work actually comes from marker-based motion capture. Here's an example, and it's getting quite old now. This is from 2006. So when they were filming and doing motion capture experiments, this is on Ronaldinho for FIFA 2007. They actually had some of the soccer players in the lab, and then they put on these reflective markers. As you can see them here in the video, you can see that he is actually wearing reflective markers. And then once you have them on, you can then track their motion in 3D by video cameras or infrared video cameras. And then, of course, you can then track any motion that you're interested in. In this case, they were also goofing around in the lab for a little bit. So, but in principle, you can measure any sort of motion that you might be interested in. So let's move on to what you can then actually use this data for and how that relates to overdetermined kinematics. So let's take a look at just a simplified situation that might occur if we actually put on some markers on some sort of body. And then I want to also make this, I want to use this data to actually drive a musculoskeletal model or model of the lower extremity based on these markers. So let's take a look. So this is actually the model that we had from before. So the now I have just completed it with the left leg as well. So we had 12 degrees of freedom on the with pelvis and the one leg, and then we have added the other leg, which adds 3 more degrees of freedom at the hip, 1 more at the knee, and 2 in the ankle. So this becomes 18 degrees of freedom in total in my musculoskeletal model that I have here. And then the motion capture experiment that was performed, which is using a quite common, but in actually a reduced marker protocol, so we would actually typically have more markers than this, but just for the sake of simplicity, these are the ones I've included. So what are here, so there would be one on the east of the axis points, so one on the left and right axis, and then there's one on sacrum. In some marker protocols, there's one on PCSI and also one on the left and right PCSI. But in this case, we just have three on pelvis, so they're illustrated over here. And then we have one on each of the lateral epicondyles of the knee, so on the left and right. We can't see it over here on the right side, but it's illustrated here as well. So we have one on left and right side of the knee. Then we have one on the malleolus, on the lateral malleolus of the ankle, and then a marker on the heel, and then one on the fifth metatarsal head. So in this case, we would have 11 markers available, and each of these then measure 3 coordinates each. So for each of these markers, we would have an X, Y, and a Z coordinate. So when we add that up, it means we have actually measured 33 coordinates, but we have a model with only 18 degrees of freedom. So actually, in this particular case, I actually have more information from the markers than I strictly need in order to make the model on the left side actually move. So how do we handle that? We could, of course, sit down and then throw away some of the marker coordinates. So we could actually just exclude until we only have 18 left, and then that would be a kinematically determinate system, and then do the analysis from that. But that's not, I mean, that's not a good idea because we're throwing away information that we actually have from the lab. So what we want to do is actually make the model follow this data here as well as it can. So I'll define in a moment what I then mean by as well as I can. So the idea that we have in anybody and the implementation there is that we can actually think of the kinematic constraint equations in two sets. So some we call hard constraints, which are here. So we call these hard constraints. And then we have the soft constraints as well. And the idea is with the hard constraints, these are ones that always have to be fulfilled. So when I have found my solution and solved my equations in the end, whatever I do, these actually have to be solved, and the residual on that should be zero within some certain tolerance that could be specified. The typical situation would be that we use these to model the joint constraint. So if I have my two potatoes here that are connected by a joint, then this could be my hard constraint. So these are my joint constraint in this case. But there's no definitive answer. I could swap them around. So whatever is called hard and soft is actually free and choosable. And then in this particular setup with the markers, I could think that I want to actually just have the distance between the marker and my modeled marker and my measured marker to be as small as possible. So these I could think of as my soft constraints, so that this vector between these two points should be as small as possible in some sort of sense. As you can probably hear, this becomes an optimization problem in the end. So we stack all the constraints that we want to just have minimized the error on in some sense, to find in a moment, in this vector. And then we have all the hard constraints that should be solved at all times. But it's not given that it's only markers that belong in the soft constraints and the joint constraint in the hard constraint. They can be swapped around. So then the way it's formulated in anybody is that we have formulated an optimization problem. So this vector of the soft constraint, we have then taken this and then made a function out of it. Because when we want to do an optimization problem, the easiest case is to make it into a scalar. So it's some sort of scalar function that we want to minimize. So this is the general formulation. So this scalar function of my constraint, my soft constraint, should be minimized, while the hard constraints, they should be fulfilled at all time steps. And the way the formulation that we have is basically a weighted least square. So we have a half out in the front, And then we have the soft constraint here, transposed times the weight matrix that can be time varying. And then we have the soft constraint again. So this becomes like a quadratic term, or also known as a weighted least square problem. In typical setup where we have markers, in most of the models that we have and most of the models people have used, we have assumed that this weight matrix is constant. And in a typical cases that we also just assume that all markers count equally much. There are some situations where if a marker drops out throughout the analysis, it might be an idea that it has weight of something and then it drops to zero so that it effectively goes out of the problem whenever it's not visible in the analysis. But actually what John will show you later will actually utilize this weight matrix for other purposes than just having a constant in some of the movement prediction examples that he will show. If you want to actually find all the details of this, there's a paper published in Computer Methods and Biomechanical and Biomedical Engineering on this that you might go read. In that paper, it's also demonstrated how you get velocities and accelerations to machine precision if you're solving an optimization problem like this. So just to illustrate how this would work, so now we've just completed the man, so this is a full, well, actually an upper body and a head. It doesn't have any arms. It might as well have. So we have the blue markers here, which are the measured markers, and then we have red modeled markers. And for this to work, we actually have to give as input the scaled model. So we actually have to specify the size of the model and the axis of rotation for all of the joints, and then also the local coordinates of all the markers. And then we give as input the initial pose and basically just a guess on where the model is standing for the first frame. And then we're solving this optimization problem for the coordinates for the first frame for time step number one. And then we get basically the solution where the distance out to all of the markers is minimized, or the vector between all of the markers is minimized in a least square sense. And then all of the joint constraints are satisfied. And then we go on in the analysis, and then we are now looking at the analysis for the i-th frame. And then we use the analysis result from the previous frame, which would look something like this. So the blue is where the markers were now, and the red is where they were before. I have actually spaced them out quite a bit. Normally we have a higher sampling frequency than this, but it's just to actually make a difference that you can see. And then you would solve for this optimization problem. And then you would then get the pose and the movement of the model for this i-th frame by solving the same optimization problem. And then you do all the way to the end. Then, as I said, there's one thing that we needed as input. So that was we needed the marker positions and the segment length and the joint axis orientation as input. But these are not some that we can just in general measure on the subject if we have them in the motion capture lab. So if I actually want to assess them on this particular human, I would need to have some sort of medical imaging, for instance, MRI or CT. You'd probably not have a full lower limb CT in any case. So actually, most of these parameters are not that easily obtainable if all you have is a motion capture experiment and a motion capture lab to get data from. So one of the ideas that we have and an approach we have in the anybody modeling system as well is that it's not only possible to generate the best, so for a given model, generate the motion that you can then get for this model, but we can actually also use optimization to find the best fitting model to the given movements that you actually have. And this is what we call parameter identification. So if you then look at the solution that we just found, so I have just introduced another variable here, it's called D. So only before I said my constraints were a function of the coordinates and time, that's because I couldn't really vary the constants, so all the segment length and the joint parameters, but these constants were of course within the constraint equation, but it was not some I could vary. But if I now think of these constraint equations as also being function of the constants, I could then actually vary the constants as well. So if, what happened before was that we had set these to some constant known value to begin with, and then I found the pose at the first step, at the i-th time step, and at the nth time step, but then depending on how I have specified these constants, I'm going to get a residual, so an objective function value here that's probably non-zero. You can actually see that there is a difference here between the blue and the red markers here and there, which could indicate that the model is not fully fitting to this particular measurement. And this would give an error at the first time step for the I've time step and for the end, so all of the time steps throughout. So what we could have as an idea was that, okay, but then couldn't I then just formulate an optimization problem that minimizes this whole sum of errors over all the time steps while varying not only the post, but actually also varies these constants that I have available so that I get the best fitting model throughout the entire motion. And that's indeed possible, and it's also implemented in the anybody modeling system. And the optimization problem that it solves, it looks like this. It becomes a fairly large scale optimization problem quite fast. But it then basically had, we have the same objective function that we had for each individual time step before, but then it actually has a sum from the first to the nth time step over there. And then it has all of the constraints to all of the time steps there as subject to constraints. And then we might actually also have some additional constraints, which are only function of our constants. So that could be that one leg has to have the same length as the other leg, if that's the constraint you want to introduce. And then it has all of the unknowns, so the pose at time step 1, 2, and all the way up to n. And then it also has all of the constants, so we can actually find the best fitting model throughout this entire motion. So we have a general and a relatively computationally efficient solution for this implemented in anybody, and I have written a paper on it. It's published in 2010, also in computer methods in biomechanics and biomedical engineering. So if you want to actually see how in detail we can solve an optimization problem in an efficient way, I would recommend that you go take a look at this paper. And then with that, I would like to hand over the word to Professor John Rasmussen, who will show you some of the more advanced uses of this over-determined kinematics. So I was showing you some of the cases where we had markers as input, but it can actually be used for more than that. And John will give you some examples on that. So thank you very much. And the word to you, John.
Thank you very much. We're going to begin with a little French lesson. So Swiss-French philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau once said, "L'homme est né libre et partout il est dans le fer," which translated into English means, the first part of it at least, that man is born free. And that is symbolized by the picture here on the left-hand side, where we have an anybody model just standing on the floor with endless motion opportunities and anything possible. However, that's not the usual case with our normal lives. We do not have endless motion opportunities in most of the things that we do, but rather we are constrained by a lot of different requirements to what it is that we're doing. So take a look at the case here on the right-hand side, where there's a person trying to get out of a vehicle, so it's what's called an egress motion. And in this motion, the person is in a constrained environment. The feet cannot penetrate the ground, he has to maintain balance to avoid falling on his nose. And he also has to stay within the confines of the door opening so as not to collide with anything while he's getting out. He can't penetrate the ground, his joints are subject to limits on ranges of motion and so on. So in fact there's a whole lot of different constraints that he must honor, which is the second part of Jean-Jacques Rousseau's quote, where he said that partout il est dans le fer, which means and everywhere he is in chains. And that's basically the idea behind the way to make models that I want to present to you here. So what if our motion planning in daily lives is actually striking a compromise between all of these many constraints that we are subjected to? And maybe those constraints are in fact too many. Just like Skipper talked about just before, we can actually in anybody, and perhaps also in our real lives, we can handle the case of too many constraints by striking compromises between them. So let's look into how that might turn into a method for generating motions in more real life situations. So what if we say that that we are born free and we are lazy? So if nothing else is required from us, we probably would just be standing on the floor, not doing very much. We could model this by assigning to all of the degrees of freedom in the body some default weak drivers that are just going to put the body into some posture. So this is again the first part, l'homme est libre, the man is born free. And then we could define stronger or even very strong drivers, which will represent the functional constraints that we're subjected to, just like I explained before on the egress example from the car. So these would then represent that we are in chains all the time. And if there's something which is not defined by these strong drivers, then the weak drivers are going to take preference and then decide what to do with the body in those situations. So this is basically the idea for generating coordinated motions in a simple way in anybody. So if we look in a little more detail at the accounts of degrees of freedom and constraints, then you can say that we begin over here on the left-hand side by the man is born free, so he has all of the motion opportunities, but then we come along with a lot of different constraints, meaning that he can't actually do very much, and what's left thereafter is a little bit of freedom remaining, meaning that we can do whatever we have to do in slightly different ways, and then we will make some reasonable kinematic consumption assumptions in terms of weak drivers, which we'll put on top of everything else, and then we will get a predicted motion coming from that. And instead of talking too much about that, I want to just give you an example of how this might work. So I'm going to close down the presentation here, and then I'm going to open up anybody. And this is a little dangerous. All sorts of things might go wrong here. But I'm going to see how it goes anyway. What you see here is a new version of anybody that's coming out. In a short while from now, this is actually version 7.0, so it has a slightly different layout from what you're used to. But don't be confused about that. It has the same basic function up here, that if I want to make a new model, I can click this icon up here in the upper left-hand corner, and I get the opportunity to make new models from some templates. And one of the templates I can choose is a standing model. So I pick the human standing here, and then I give it a name, so we could call this Webcast, since this is what we're doing at the moment. And if I say OK to that, the model is going to create a new model for me. And you see the model here. I can actually load the model just like it is, and that's going to work out okay, I hope. And we can see what the model is when it's loaded in just a few seconds. So the model is actually just a person standing on the floor. Just a second, it'll be ready. Here we go, so I can twist it around a little bit. And I could actually also run the analysis. I'm not going to do that because the model doesn't do anything. It's a completely static model that doesn't go anywhere. So this is governed by a set of drivers on all of the degrees of freedom. And these drivers ensure that the model stays in this posture that we have here. However, there's one other constraint that we should bear in mind right now, and that is that the model is also required to maintain balance. So there's a constraint on the collective center of mass of all of the segments in the model, that this has to be exactly above the footprint. So the model stays in balance. Whatever motion we impose on it, it's going to adjust the body posture so that it stays in static balance. There's a couple of things I want to change about this before we go on with the model. I want to get rid of the muscles, and I also want to add a couple of strong drivers to the feet so that the feet stay where they are. I'm not going to rely on the weak drivers in the model for that, because I want the feet to stay on the same spot on the ground, so we don't get any skating around of the feet when we start doing the model. And of course, to make things smooth and swift, I pre-cooked a model for that. I have a couple of things that I can insert. So I have a webcast one here, and if we go into that, I have a file here called includes, which I can load. And so the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take these guys here, and I'm going to cut them out, and then I'm going to insert them into my main model over here. Like that. Okay. So if I load the model like this, now hopefully the muscles should disappear. This will only mean that things go faster than they otherwise would. So I'm going to go back to the includes here. There's some other stuff in here which I'm going to use later. I won't talk about that now. But I have a couple of drivers here for the right ankle and for the left ankle. So these are basically going to keep the feet in a fixed position. So I'm going over here, and the easiest thing I can do is actually to save this file into my webcast folder here, like that. So that was the folder that the system generated for me just before, and then I will go here and I will write somewhere around here. I will write includes.any, I think was the name of the file. So let's just try loading that again. Oh, and I have a little double slash there. So that's all that's necessary. And now I have the feet. I have the feet fixed to the floor. So if I run the initial conditions here, it's going to fall into place, and the feet are going to remain in this position. So now I'm kind of ready to work with my model. So over here in includes, I have an additional thing that I want to specify. So I have down here a driver. This is an endpoint driver for the hand. And so I'm just going to enable this one. And what's going to happen here is that now I'm going to define the driver, which is the hand motion here, and it's going to drive the position of the right hand. And this position goes from wherever it is now. I already measured that. These are the original positions. And then they're going to go to some other position with the velocity vector shown here. So what it's going to do is, the first one here is the x coordinate, that is the forward coordinate, so it's going to reach 20 centimeters forward, and then it's going to reach half a meter downwards, and then it's going to reach 20 centimeters medially. So the minus 0.2 here is 20 centimeters in the z direction, so that would be the medial direction for this model. So now what I've done is I have imposed a strong driver that moves the hands on top of all the weak drivers that I have in the model. And so what the model is going to do now when I run this is it's going to do a coordinated motion that will move the hand as I have specified here. But more importantly, it's going to move all of the other degrees of freedom in a compromising way such that they accommodate this movement of the hands. So so let's try to load this in. And then once this is done, in just a second, I'm going to pick the kinematics over here, and then I will run the kinematics. And then we'll see what happens. So you can see now the model is going to make some sort of coordinated motion that is going to bring the hand down along the vector that I specified. And this is going to have an effect on all of the other degrees of freedom in the body. Problem here, of course, is that it might not have exactly the effect that I was hoping for. Let me just switch this one off. So it might not be exactly the effect that I was hoping for. We can try to replay the motion, and then maybe you can see that this is kind of a strange motion, or at least a little bit strange. So this is what it's doing. It's accommodating. It's doing the task that I was asking it to do. But I would probably, if I were doing this task, I would probably bend more forward and not bend so much laterally. Of course, there are two ways you can do this. You can bend in many different ways to reach that point. And it seems the model has done something that I'm not completely happy with. So in order to tweak that and to make it do something that I'm more happy with, what I can go and do is I can go and change my weak drivers a little bit. All of those weak drivers are located inside a file called the mannequin file. And the mannequin file is in the main model. It is linked right here. So I can just open that up. And when I do that, I can go down and find a section here that's called posterior velocity. And then I can say, oh, well, I would like to have a little more pelvis thorax flexion. This is pelvis thorax extension here, so I'm just going to put in a negative number, say minus, 30 degrees. And then I would also like to have a little bit more hip flexion, perhaps. So hip flexion here could also be, say, 30 degrees. I have no idea whether this is a good value, but it's kind of going in the direction that I wanted it to. So let's try again and see if this is going to mean any difference to the motion that I get and make it a more realistic motion. So if we now turn it a little bit sideways, you can see that, yes, we do indeed now get more hip flexion and we also get more spine flexion, so he's reaching down in a different way from what he was doing before, and with not so much lateral bending as we had before. So we can just try to replay this one again, and so you see now we get this motion. So in just one step I have created something which might be a little more realistic than what we had before. If I was still not happy with this, I would of course change a few other parameters over here, and pretty quickly I could come up with a motion that is at least plausible. There might be one other problem with this one. You can see there is an overextension of the right knee. And this is, of course, because if you want to bend over like that, it would be a great thing, a great idea, if the knee would only bend that way, then that could contribute to the motion. That's not really the case for real knees. So we have something extra in the mannequin file that in the include file here that we can implement. This extra thing is a new type of drivers that has been implemented, and so I'm just going to pick this this include file here called jointlimitstemplates.any. This include file is something that's going to make the model adhere to range of motion constraints, and I'll explain how that works in just a second. For now, I'm just going to take a copy of that and put over into my main file here and place that up here. And then I'll just go to my file manager, because I also need that include file. This is included over here in my model, so this has a couple of files that I need, which I'm just gonna copy, and I'm gonna put them into the webcast model over here that was generated like that. Okay, so we're gonna get back to that in just a second. I just want to explain to you how this actually works, because it's actually within the same kind of system as what I just explained to you. So remember when Skipper did his thing just before, he explained how we make this compromise between the soft constraints, and he said that was a quadratic form, and the quadratic form of the penalization of constraint violation we have up here. This is actually taken from Skipper's paper on the matter, and you can see the quadratic form is that the weak constraint times itself times a weight function here in the middle. This is what makes up the quadratic form. And so if you look at the relationship between constraint violation and the penalization that we get, then that would be different parabolas like these. We could then have different values of the weight function, and we could have the parabola more or less steep depending on the value of the weight function. Normally this weight function is a constant, but notice that it can be a function. So if we kind of design a function that is specially made for the purpose we need, then maybe we can extract other behaviors of the model than what we have here. And so in particular, the one that I will suggest is that instead of having the constraint function on the previous slide, we are going to use one that looks like this. So you see this weight function is such that it is completely flat within and zero, in fact, within a certain range. And this certain range is the range of motion of a given joint or a territorial constraint like not hitting the doorframe, for instance. But if we go outside this flat area, so if we go outside the range of motion, then we get a steep increase of the value of the weight function. Now, if we use a weight function that behaves like that, then we effectively have a territorial constraint, because the constraint is not going to care what happens as long as we stay within this limit, within the range of motion. But it's going to prevent us from going outside the range of motion, at least from going very much outside the range of motion. Now, this is a little bit complicated to make in any script, and that is why we have made it in such a way that we have a predefined template file for that, and that is the one that we have here. This is going to be made available on our wiki page very soon, so you can actually download it from there. Now I have implemented it into my model, and over here in my includes, I can then, after this has been included, I can enable this part here, which is all that you have to do. So this actually creates a set of territorial or range of motion constraints, and you can do it either on particular degrees of freedom separately, or you can use the one here, which is the one I'm using. You can just enable all of the joint limits in one go, so that's what I've done here. So this creates maybe a little more constraints than I actually need, but as long as none of the other degrees of freedom are challenging the range of motion, then they are not going to have any effect. So let's try to load this and then have a look again at how the model now behaves. It might run a little bit slower now than it did before, because now it has to strike a compromise between many more constraints than it did before. But what you're hopefully going to see is that now we have done away with the tendency for overextension of the knees. So now it's going to try to bend forward and pick up whatever it is that it's trying. Oh, the last one failed. That's because it fails to maintain balance in the last step, but we can still replay it like this, and you can see now we get a motion that doesn't overextend any of the joints. Before we end, I have one more example that I would like to show you. And I think I'm actually going to stay over here and then just load the model that I wanted. Maybe we can just close all of this, and then I can go over here and I'll take it from a recent file list here. Tailgate. So I'm going to load a new model now. And this model is a model of somebody closing the tailgate of a station wagon. Okay, so I don't have the whole station wagon. I have a standing model here, which is just exactly like the one I made before. And then I have a tailgate here, which is rotating about a hinge. I don't have the rest of the station wagon, because we're not really going to use that. I'm just going to make a simple change in my model. So I'm just going into here in the joints and drivers, and then I will disable a joint that I have here before I load the model. So that's what I'm going to do now. And then we'll do a simple analysis of that. So what we have now is we have the tailgate, which is moving, and then we have the standing model here, which only has the weak drivers that I talked about before. So it doesn't have anything else. And then the drivers that keep the feet on the floor. So if I start this running, you will see what's going to happen is that now the tailgate is going to close, because I have a driver on the tailgate that closes it. But the body model is not doing anything, because we haven't connected the body model with the tailgate, and therefore the body model doesn't have anything to do except follow its weak drivers, which I set up in this posture that you see here. I elevated the arm a little bit so that the hand sort of comes close to the handle of the tailgate, but not actually very close, just so that it's sort of in the vicinity for when the two are going to be connected in just a second. So please bear with me for a second while the tailgate is closing, and in the meantime I can just re-enable this joint that we have here, so that the next time we run it, the hand will be connected to the tailgate, and the weak drivers of the body have to accommodate the motion of the hand following the tailgate. So this is gonna finish in just a second. We're running 100 iterations here. It's a little finer resolution than the one we had before. So please bear with me for just 7 more iterations. And there we go. So again, I can replay this so that you can see at a slightly larger speed that it's just the tailgate that's moving and the body isn't actually doing anything at all. Like that. Okay, so let's try to, now we have re-enabled the joint here between the hand and the handle on the tailgate. So I'm going to load the model again with a new setting with this connection enabled, and then we're going to run the analysis once again. And you will now see that the hand now gets connected to the tailgate, and the body has to bend backwards a little bit to make some space to allow the person to actually grab the tailgate. And the hand now starts following the tailgate down, and the body, all of the joints of all of the degrees of freedom of the body are now moving in order to accommodate the motion of the tailgate and also to remain in static balance all the time. So this is why when the body is bending backwards, initially you can see the pelvis goes forward a little bit, and when the body now starts to bend forward, the pelvis is going to go backwards in order to maintain static balance, because that was one of the drivers that we had in the model. And again, we're just going to make to allow the analysis to run, and then we can run it afterwards on in a slightly higher speed. So please bear with me for a few seconds yet. You can follow the development of time steps over here, and you can see that it takes a little bit of time for each time step. This is of course because we're in fact solving an optimization problem that is very nonlinear and which has several hundred variables. We solve that optimization problem at each time step, so the computer is really working hard here. And we're half finished. And yeah, you can actually see in here, in this highlighted, the section that I'm highlighting now, you can see the center of mass driver. This is the constraint that makes sure that the body is maintaining its balance while the motion is going on. So it's actually very simple to define. So it's just this little part here that specifies that the body must stay in static balance. So let's just give it a chance to run the final few iterations, about 10 iterations left now. Replay this at a slightly higher speed, you get a better impression of how the model is moving. So there you go. Yeah, so that's most of what I had to show you. Let's go back to the presentation for the final few words. So the conclusions here. First of all, the video here on the right-hand side of course shows that after you have done this tailgate simulation, you can then add the muscles again to the model, and you can of course do an inverse dynamic analysis and calculate ground reaction forces and forces in the muscles and joints and so on. But the basic conclusions of this is that by using this over-determinate system, the over-determinacy of the constraints, or the Jean-Jacques Rousseau principle, if you will, is a simple way to synthesize coordinated motions. So the model is all the time trying to honor the constraints of balance and range of motion and territorial constraints and the connections to the environment and so on. And then between all of these constraints, it's going to come up with a coordinated motion that that typically involves all of the degrees of freedom of the model. This is not a totally automatic process, but you can come to reliable motions with a few mouse clicks. You don't need any experimental input for this. You actually just need to set up your environment and place the model in relation to the environment and set up the constraints and then run the analysis. So I think this is a good way of generating models that do complicated coordinated motions, not motions of any particular individual doing this at any particular time, but motions that are plausible in sense of how some individual might be accommodating the constraints that make up the environment of this motion. And with that, I thank you very much for your attention and give the word back to Announce.